Welcome to Countdown to Infinity, a Marvel's Avengers podcast. We talk all things Marvel Cinematic Universe, and we're awaiting the release of Ant-Man and the Wasp Quantumania, which comes out in just a couple of weeks. And so while we are waiting, we're going back into the vault and re-releasing our first Ant-Man episode. So last week we released the episode from 2018 talking about Ant-Man. And this week we're releasing our Ant-Man and the Wasp episode. This is really fun, but keep in mind that this was before the release of Avengers Infinity War and Avengers Endgame. Luckily for us, there wasn't that much apart from, of course, Scott and the way that he, you know, joins the rest of the Avengers in attacking Thanos in Endgame. And he's actually a pretty big part of going back in time. But apart from that, his character is, you know, stays the same, quite at least during those Avengers films. So it doesn't reflect too much on the pod. But keep that in mind. We haven't seen Avengers Infinity War and Endgame by the time that this episode was recorded. But it's a whole lot of fun. John and Drew are on this episode. It's nice to go back, but this is just so you can remember a little bit about what our thoughts were on Ant-Man and Ant-Man and the Wasp before we talk about Quantumania. Next week, we'll have a big preview show. We'll talk Kang. We'll talk Ant-Man. We'll talk about the Quantum Realm. We'll talk about all that stuff next week. And soon we will have brand new MCU content to talk about. That'll be really, really exciting because it's been a while. It's been at least a month or two since the last thing that was new that released was Guardians of the Galaxy, the holiday special, which was great, but it's been 2 or 3 months. So we'll be talking about Ant-Man, the Wasp, Quantumania soon enough, and I can't wait for that. But until then, enjoy Ant-Man and the Wasp, our re-released from 2018. I hope you like it. If you want to hear brand new episodes of this show and a bunch of others, you can go to patreon.com/delfinpod, D-E-L-F-I-N-P-O-D, and you can get, I believe we have 2 a week now, 2 new episodes a week, not always on Marvel, but we've got video pods there. John and Drew are there too. But that's on patreon.com/shelfandpod. Without further ado, here's our re-release from 2018, Ant-Man and the Wasp. Welcome to this brand new episode of Countdown to Infinity, an Avengers podcast.
Did you forget how to say that? It sounded like you had like a pause there. It's like, welcome to...
It's been a while.
It's been a while.
I don't forget to how to...
how to talk.
how to spoke.
Oh boy. Great start. I don't forget how to start this because I say it every day, whether or not we're recording. I look in the mirror...
Motivational speech.
And I say, welcome to Countdown to Infinity, an Avengers podcast. Welcome to life, baby. Well, we're going to start this with our titular countdown, although we have already gotten to Infinity.
Right. Yeah, technically.
This makes no sense now.
Now we're on to Infinity.
So, like,
plus two, part two?
Ooh,
plus
that's one. That's my pants size.
Plus one.
Infinity plus one.
Oh, shit.
It's big. It's been a rough couple of months for me. I legit have gained weight, though. I don't know what's going on.
Yeah, maybe it's because I'm older.
Yeah, you're looking real thick, girl.
Thank you. Well, T-H-I-C-C. You know, I've been wanting to make him clap for a long, long time. And now I can. Let me do it so I can hear. Okay, ready? Hold on. Let me just put my mic down.
Oh.
Yep.
Gross.
Yeah, sorry, guys. Made him clap.
That was quite a sight.
Yeah. Anyways, yeah, sorry. This is an all audio medium. Anyways, let's count this baby down. I guess we've done all of the other ones, so we're going to start with 0 and go to -1. Ready?
0, -1.
Boom, done. This is Ant-Man and the Wasp.
I just have one question. When Cap needed help, if I'd asked you, would you have come?
I guess we'll never know. But if you had, you'd have never been caught.
I do some dumb things, and the people I love the most, they pay the price.
Thanks to you, we had to run. We're still running.
Let's go.
Welcome back. Welcome back to Countdown to Infinity, an Avengers podcast. If this is your very first episode, boy, are there plenty others for you to listen to.
But if you're watching this movie, then for sure hopefully this isn't your first episode, because damn.
Yeah, you are confused.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, especially at the end of that one.
So Countdown to Infinity, it's a podcast where we watch every single Marvel Cinematic Universe movie. And then we talk about it. We have a trivia game. And it's all leading up to whatever's next for Marvel. The second movie, which we still don't know the title to.
They might be canceled.
Cancel
Marvel.
Yeah. That'd be crazy if it just ends with everyone.
Yeah. Nope, that's it.
Nope. Whoop.
This is the best we got.
But let's go around. Let's introduce ourselves. It's been a while. So for some of you, you may want to hear an update on our lives. So let's all give them an update on what's going on. My name is Emmanuel. Not much.
My name is John, also not much.
My name is Andrew, formerly Andrew. My name is now Andrea. I'm just kidding.
Whoa.
I've become my twin.
He's a Wachowski brother.
Wachowski?
Oh, I don't know. What's their name?
Wachowski?
Ilana and
Ilan? I don't know.
It's been a while since we've done an episode of this because there hasn't been a new Marvel Cinematic Universe movie.
I know. What up with that, Marvel?
Yeah, you guys should be making one every single week.
Every month.
Well, they made Deadpool in the middle of all that stuff. That's really a Fox thing, though. But
Fox.
I felt like it kind of...
maybe Marvel.
Yeah, there was a little bit of a wait there for... Hey,
how do you think I should vote? I'm supposed to vote at this Disney shareholders meeting. Oh, I have one vote out of the 15 million. Should I vote to buy Fox or not to buy Fox?
Could you imagine? That could swing it, though, because they're like, what if we won by just one vote?
And it was me.
Yeah, and then...
No, don't buy it. I would vote for it, I think.
No, just say no.
Okay, cool.
Just go against the crowd.
I'll go against the crowd. We need to buy DreamWorks. Imagine a Shrek crossover with...
101 Dalmatians.
With Mickey Mouse. Yeah. Oh, man. And then Donkey.
The Shrek Mickey holiday special.
Mm. Like, I'm making waffles. Oh!
Nope. Oh, I was like, what?
That's Mickey Mouse. That's
exactly what happened.
Doing the donkey line. Nice.
Anyways, well, we're back this week because Ant-Man and the Wasp has come out.
Has come.
Ant-Man and the Wasp has come?
Mm-hmm. Hard.
Pretty hard.
Okay, cool. So we're going to talk about it. So here's how this is going to work. We're going to talk about our first thoughts. It'll be spoiler-free. And then we're going to take a break before we dive into the spoiler zone. And we talk about what this movie means to the Marvel Cinematic Universe. And all of the little things that are in this movie. And I say little because it's about...
Nice. Small.
Small things. Small things. I will not go. Turn the light. Nope, am I not saying it right?
No, you were right.
Turn the lights off. Carry me home.
Na, 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 na. Well, you stopped.
Oh, na, 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 na,
no,
na.
No, you, okay.
Ant-Man and
the crowd
Wasp.
Missed this.
I know. We're sorry that you
shaking off the rust.
It's been 2 months since you heard us really just fuck around.
Fuck around.
We are now realizing, man, how much time have I wasted on this? Not much, just 12 hours, honestly, right?
Yeah. Maybe around that.
We cut out most of it.
Yeah,
this is our 18. We've been going at it for a while.
So what did you guys think of Ant-Man and the Wasp?
Wop.
Ant-Man and...
Andrew, you want to go first? It's your rapid.
First impressions, you said? Nice.
Yeah.
It was cool. It's funny. I was sitting in the theater, and obviously, it depends on when you listen to this, but I have seen it twice already. The first time, I kind of didn't know what to think. I know that I liked it, but I didn't know what I liked about it. I just knew that I was entertained and I was having a good time. This second time around, I thought it was pretty interesting because I think it's one of the freshest franchises because nobody else can come close to what he does. Like no power is like similar, I guess, to Ant-Man. He's kind of in a league of his own. So even with this one, they still haven't broke a lot of ground that they could do with the effects and things like that. I feel like the quantum realm was in like 2 minutes of this movie. You know, it was so short, but they can dive into a lot more things. It's going to be interesting to see how what role he plays in the next Avengers. But I thought it was really, really cool. It's I think Ant-Man is slowly becoming one of my favorite, more favorite. Marvel heroes, but they were able to even step up their game in you know, cast wise also, which was pretty cool because the first one had already a great cast. It was pretty underrated, but with this one, I think it whatever good parts they took from that they saw from the first one, they ended up saying, hey, let's do more of that. Which, why wouldn't you do that, since that's the thing that ended up working for you? But all around, good job for everybody, and it's pretty crazy to see on where this fits in the whole MCU, just in general. And again, the bigger role he might play when, you know, some of these cats stop doing what they're doing, you know, whether that's Tony Stark or Robert Downey Jr., he gets too old or something. Where is he going to be, one of the leader characters, or is he going to be one of those supporting role characters, you know? But overall, I think, again, they kind of struck a chord here, and they didn't show too much, so that way they can pick up the stakes in the next one. This one was a very personal, I think, story for them, you know, with basically them trying to get the original Wasp back. Played by Michelle Pfeiffer.
Michelle Pfeiffer, the original Catwoman.
Yeah, I know. Which is, those are two really cool titles to have, the Wasp and Catwoman.
Both. My two favorite animals, the cats and wasps. Nice.
Well, and they're two super vital characters to their mythology. So it is really, really cool to finally see Ant-Man and the Wasp finally take the screen, because they're really, really big members of the Avengers, with Hank Pym creating Ultron at one point, you know, and things like that. So they're super big parts again of the Marvel Foundation. So to see them finally get their due diligence or justice, it's pretty awesome.
Nice.
Yeah, I kind of I didn't know if I really liked this movie. I guess like I've also seen it twice, I guess.
You guys but are such like, braggarts, okay? I've
seen it 2.3 times.
You said first impression, so I was like, fuck. But like, if my actual true first impressions was I didn't know if I liked it, because it was a lot thrown at you. Almost like I got vibes of Infinity War because of the amount of, without spoiling anything, the amount of subplots and stuff in the movie that actually happened. Because there's a lot of stuff that happens in this movie, and it's a lot to digest. You know, and then, but I do like the approach that they went to it, because I was telling Drew earlier that like this movie kind of feels like a romantic comedy, and it's pretty.
To shorten that, let's call it a rom-com.
A rom-com.
Let's agree to that.
Let's coin the term rom-com.
Rom-com.
Let's coin the term.
Yeah.
That's so it's nice to have that type of like movie, because the first one is like a very much almost like a heist film.
This one's kind of like that a little bit.
Sort of a little bit. This one's more of a Chase of MacGuffin type of storyline, if you kind of think of it. But overall, it's like kind of I found it kind of funnier than the first one, which is kind of weird, because I think I remember, I don't know if I said this on the podcast or not, or you know, maybe the audience can obviously fact check, but I felt like the first one's humor is kind of a little, at times, a little weird and forced, because it was coming off of Edgar Wright's, you know, specific brand of humor, and is like, you know, his his humor that's basically all in the visual language.
Yeah, it's a visual humor, and this is situational almost.
This one's a little bit more towards like, this one's an actually, like the first one you can totally tell that the bones of Edgar Wright's story was there. This one is its own thing, like really, really different.
Same even director, totally, right? Different.
Same director and everything. So this guy Peyton Reed had the chance to build something from the ground up this time, as opposed to, you know, just working off of somebody else's working off of someone else's script, basically. So, but overall, it's a really fun time. I think it's actually the most upbeat out of all the movies we've gotten, especially, and not just because it's come off after Infinity War. I mean, it may seem that way because Infinity War was so
depressing.
Such a depressing, like kind of like ending there for that one. So it's kind of it's refreshing to have this type of like, you know, little small stakes story. Again, like the first one, but like, you know, full of humor and like just, and even like, I think Sophia had said it earlier too. She doesn't have a mic, but she's somewhere around here.
Yeah, she's safe.
She's she's hidden.
Stronghold.
We live in a very
you're making me forget
place.
My fucking thought.
Okay. Just like, she said something.
She did, and now I lost it.
Okay, cool.
No. She had said something how she didn't like that wasn't it. Was it something else after that? It was No antagonist. There you go. She said something. She's feeding me lines through an earpiece. Okay. she said she didn't like the way that there was no real antagonist in the movie, and I get that because there really isn't. Like,
there's no conventional.
Yeah, exactly.
When I was sitting in the theater, starting to like speculate right before the movie came on. I was like, "What if it's Michelle Pfeiffer?"
I thought that originally too.
Because you need a big name like to hold up the villain, you know. And not all the time. Sometimes you get these people who like Tom Hiddleston, where like Marvel kind of built his career essentially. But it is interesting because in the comics, Hank Pym is one of the more abusive heroes, and
he has issues, right? He's an alcoholic. He's made a lot of enemies. Rageaholic.
Yeah, so I thought they were gonna flip the script, and maybe she was gonna be the one that was like, "Oh, I'm attacking the family," or something, you know, something. Be the big family. The
but I'm glad they didn't go with that at all.
But and then I thought of Lawrence Fishburne, and I was like, "Huh, maybe."
But not even, right?
But even kinda, then, yeah, like, maybe, sort of, maybe.
So,
maybe.
Yeah, basically, so like at the very end, you don't really get into, without getting into that spoilerific part, you don't really get a very conventional antagonist out of this. Almost like not really a villain, if you think about it.
Yeah.
But
it's more of like a race against time type of thing. Like we need to complete this objective before this happens.
And I think that's like, even if that was, even if that didn't really stick the landing, I think it's still pretty cool and unique to have as a part of the series. Because it is very small scale and really, like, the stakes are your friends, in this case, your friends or your family that's going to, like, get bitten. Yeah.
And I think that's what makes this movie really special, is it's not as crazy and insane in the scope of the other Marvel movies, where the galaxy's ending, or obviously there's some Thanos thing happening. It's a very human and family-oriented story, which is really unique. But I think you're right. It was definitely funnier. I mean, subjective, I guess. That's subjective. Of course, it's up to people to say think if it's funnier, but I just think it has built in comedy because you have things shrinking and growing, and that's already funny. But yeah, so I definitely think there's a lot of humor in the way this movie was written. There are a lot of storylines and a lot of people from the original that you care about, like his old crew from prison that you want to see more of. Now, correct me if I'm wrong, but the little girl in this movie is his
daughter,
and that chemistry is so special.
Yeah,
it's so good.
It starts you with it too.
She's one of the best actresses in the movies. Like, she's really funny.
She's so cute.
Oh,
she's like so adorable that like it hurts. Like like when you want to like just pinch the baby's cheeks.
Okay, all right, calm down.
I said pinch a baby's cheeks,
like face cheeks.
Yeah.
So this movie is really, really funny. But it definitely deals with the cloud of Infinity War over it, because I went in thinking, what are the connections? And so the beginning of this movie had to be so personal so that you forget about that. So that way they make it very clear that the stakes are us retrieving Wasp from the quantum dimension.
Yeah.
And I mean, overall, even the villain in the movie, what's the name of the villain?
Ghost.
I never saw her. I'm just kidding, no, she's a ghost. Even Ghost's story arc was really insane. We talked about this as the overarching theme of a lot of these Marvel movies are that sins of the father thing.
Family.
Right.
Yeah. And that still kind of applies to this because Hank Pym's past is coming around in a little bit in a way with the things that I guess people have perceived him
Are we going
doing.
Into spoiler?
No, we're not spoiling. Okay. No. There is still that same thread that you know goes through all of the same Marvel movies that goes through this movie, so it's connected thematically, not just in title, to totally all true. Of the other Marvel movies too.
Yeah, Guardians has similar themes to that, like father and children. Yeah. So that'd be pretty cool.
And it also does a really good job at explaining like the aftermath of Civil War, the impact that happened to him, and why he's not there in Infinity War.
Yeah.
Because, you know, they basically run through that in the first, you know, 10 minutes.
It's the big question people have probably going into this.
Yeah, like,
if you've seen Infinity
War. Well, and he's one of their big guns.
Have you seen Countdown to Infinity War?
Have you seen Countdown?
If you've been listening to the podcast, they're based on movies.
Yeah.
These podcasts are based on films. Watch the films.
I mean, you saw in Civil War, he was one of their big guns, literally taking on all of Team Iron Man by himself.
Yeah, and
so
you wondered,
you know, why isn't he punching Thanos out of the sky?
And there's so much left to be explored with what he can do when he shrinks. Mm-hmm. But yeah, I think this movie's a blast to watch. It's funny. It's filled with action. I think some action scenes that can only be in an Ant-Man movie.
Yeah.
Because he grows and shrinks and grows and shrinks.
It's got water bears.
Yeah, well, exactly. Boom.
Which is science. So technically, this is a scientific movie.
Technically.
Yeah. It's set in a different place than the other Marvel movies. It's set in San Francisco. Mm-hmm. San Fran.
Not SF New York or anything on the, like...
Not New York, not Sokovia.
Yeah.
Yeah, Cornucopia.
Even though they do say Sokovia Accords in it once.
They do.
Spoiler alert.
Okay, I was like, we'll get it.
Spoiler.
I'm just kidding.
Some of the stuff that they bring up from the Marvel movies, I feel like they kind of like doing it like in tongue-in-cheek, like almost like making fun of it in a way. Sort of.
And they do it so quick that you're just like, it has to be part of it. Yeah. You know?
And the tension is still there, though, because you're right, it's a race against time. But it's a race against time against multiple things
that's actually happening
that he needs to get to. Yeah. It's boom, boom, boom. He has to get out of here.
It's almost like a rat race. You got multiple parties racing for like the same thing almost at some points.
And then also Ant-Man racing for different things because he's under house arrest and you know there's that whole thing that happens too. But yeah, great casting, great everything else. Well, guys, is there anything to add to our spoiler-free review before we go into the spoiler zone, the quantum spoiler zone. Anything you guys want to add?
Yeah, Thanos dies in this one.
Uh-oh.
Got you.
We're going to take our very first break, where we're going to talk to you guys about an ad. And that ad is this.
But the story didn't end there.
If you're wondering what that was, have we got news for you? This isn't our only podcast. We have, for the last 3 fucking years, 4 years maybe? Could it be 4 years?
I think it's three.
3 years?
Yeah.
We've been podcasting for a while now, and we have over 100 episodes. We can't even tell you how many hours that is, because some of them are 2 or 3 hours long.
Right, yeah.
Let's just round it and say we have 150 hours of things for you to listen to.
At the least.
Yeah. Of a show called Revenge of the Sequel. It's a podcast just about sequels. It's actually what got us started about over this Marvel biz,
because
all these are technically sequels and prequels.
Right.
But we watch
movies.
We're
cheating right now when we do Countdown to Infinity.
We watch new sequels. We watch old sequels. Name some of the old sequels we watch. What's the oldest sequel you think we've done?
The oldest sequel? Oh, no. We've done some classics like Day of the Dead.
Mm-hmm.
We've done some... Fuck, now I can't even think of it. There
you
go.
Jaws 2 was old.
Jaws 2 is pretty awesome.
Even things...
Jaws 3, my bad. I think Jaws 2 is unreleased.
Oh, boy. There's a lot. I'm trying to think now.
There's so many.
There's a lot of movies. We watch a lot of movies, and some things are new too.
Some things are new, and if you're a fan of the Marvel stuff, we have covered. Like you'll get our actual first impressions on Age of Ultron. Yeah. On a past episode like that.
But not only do you have us, we have a lot of guests on the show, and some of them are special because they're in the movie we're talking about.
Oh yeah.
So
sometimes they've made the movie that we're talking about.
Yeah. We've talked to Robert Rodriguez, indie movie darling. We've talked to Sean Gunn. He's on the podcast. Lloyd Kaufman is on our 100th episode from Troma.
Yeah, Ken Foray from Dawn of the Dead.
So many good people. I think we interviewed the voice of SpongeBob.
Tom Kenny.
Oh, he's not in the sequel. He is. SpongeBob SquarePants.
That's right.
We gotta do
that's
that.
Probably
SpongeBob
Underwater.
Future app.
We have an unreleased interview with a guy from Clerks as well. But find Revenge of the Sequel anywhere you find Countdown to Infinity. It'll be there. And so much good stuff for you, baby. Kisses.
Whatever.
Yeah, just keep going right now.
Welcome back from that break. We're now in the quantum
realm.
Spoiler zone.
Hell of a break.
We've all shrunk down to the size of an ant. We're talking to microphones.
It's just because it's cold in here.
Oh, sorry. That's not what we were talking about.
Wait, what?
Would you rather shrink to be smaller or bigger?
You kind of think you can shrink to be bigger.
Would you rather shrink or grow? Are you a grower or a shrinker?
You put it on Wumbo? I put it on Wumbo, baby.
I don't know. The Ant-Man powers are really... Like, it's cool to have both options, which is like really cool about the hair.
Because I'm super allergic to ants.
Whoa. Oh, yeah, we've established this in the first Ant-Man.
You would be a perfect Ant-Man then, so they won't sting you.
Yeah, well, I was outside and you had ants like right on the... And you never have ants. Right on the front porch. And
do we really?
Yeah. And they're the big ones. I'm like, ooh, these are the ones that kill me.
You know, one of them bit Sophia in bed the other day.
Holy...
And freak. It was insane.
Yeah.
It was wild. They're probably everywhere.
Yeah, I know. Now I'm real paranoid, but this is the best.
Maybe it's because we have constant sugar water just pouring just everywhere.
Flowing through pipes.
Flowing through our pipes. I always have a loose papaya in my pocket.
Papaya?
You sweat sugar?
Sweat sugar and glucose. I roll around. That's probably why I have hands. I think I would grow bigger because when I'm small, I could be, you know, there are so many things that would kill me.
That's true. No, but Ant-Man's power is... Oh, okay. So you're only talking about the changing sizes? Because Ant-Man's power is he has the same strength of a man when he's small. So if he were to punch you when he was small, it'd feel like a grown man.
If he's a big man, if he's giant man...
He has the same punch of a... I'm just kidding.
That was a baby?
Yeah, just like...
But it seems like they established this movie, he gets tired. When he uses all his energy.
Burns a bunch of energy, yeah.
Interesting. All right, well, let's talk about this movie. What do you guys think about Ant-Man? Did you guys watch it?
And the Wasp.
We'll talk about her later. No, I'm just kidding. No, Ant-Man and the Wasp. What I thought one of the more clever parts of this was him being under house arrest and the friction between him and, I guess, the... Pims.
Yeah, Hank Pym.
Hank Pym. Or Pym.
The Van Dyne.
Yeah, that friction, that conflict was so good because it sort of made him choose between what he wanted to do and
family.
Because if he doesn't, he's technically a criminal, which is odd because...
Well, now he's trying to redeem himself with his business where he's like a security expert, you know?
So well, one of the things that makes him unique is he doesn't have... he doesn't have complete freedom because he has a kid. I don't think Captain America has a child.
Well, and I think that's partially why, in the beginning, obviously it starts with him and his daughter, you know.
Yeah.
Basically trying to find a way to entertain themselves because he's on house arrest. Can't leave the house for 2 years. He's on probation for 3 years after that. So
I hear that.
Yeah.
You guys know what I'm talking about.
But
ankle bracelet.
It's pretty interesting because you get that. What's the Wu agent Wu?
Jimmy Wu, who's Agents of Atlas.
Yeah,
Agents of Atlas.
He's a hilarious actor.
Oh yeah,
Randall Park.
Off the boat.
Yeah, exactly.
What's that movie where he plays Kim Jong-un?
The interview.
Yeah, and so he's funny. A hilarious addition again. So to see him in that reoccurring role. Was pretty awesome, but he basically explains the Sokovia Accords things and why Van Dyne and Pym are on the run. You know, they violated the Accords because it's their tech in the giant man suit, so that was pretty cool to put that in actual perspective.
Just to tie it into the bigger universe, because at this point, I think that's the only thing that connects it, at least at this point in the movie, because this thing is pretty standalone.
Yeah.
I feel like it's even more standalone than that first movie.
Yeah.
Like, way more.
Yeah, and then again, that house arrest thing where he's so close to getting out, so now he needs to tippy-toe, but now all this stuff is finally, basically hitting the fan. He's went 2 years without this, and it basically explains on why Hawkeye and him aren't in the mix for Infinity War, because they both have families, and they're the only ones that are tied down something like that.
That's insane.
You know, Iron Man has Pepper Potts, but she's in on it too, you know? She's in on the whole superhero
game. And they're on a different plane. They're so powerful and rich, and they have... resources, unlike, you're right, Hawkeye and
Captain America, anyone who wasn't with Iron Man.
Well, because Captain America has family, but it's another superhero, Bucky.
Yeah, you know? That's true.
And then Sharon Carter finally died.
Because you'd figure if Ant-Man didn't, he would just be in Wakanda.
Yeah, exactly. He'd be helping.
Scot-free.
And the thing that's crazy is that, Hank Pym, you think he's all powerful, but you end up figuring out that he only had one suit and Ant-Man used it to go fight the Avengers. And now they're like, oh, we have no suits.
Well, that's it. It was such a great way to explain. And I'm wondering now whether or not that was something they planned originally. I mean, they obviously wanted to have movies still playing before the next Infinity War. It only makes sense. You can't build up something and then have the second movie come out, in 2 months.
Did Lord of the Rings do that? Return of the King? Or how long was it before?
I don't know. We'll look it up. Yeah.
A year each between those movies.
It's the
same
thing with Harry Potter?
Yeah.
Harry Potter was
Deathly Hallows Part 1 and 2, because every Harry Potter movie was like a year and a half, a year between releases, and then after a while it started being like 2 years.
You got to get that weight in there. But that anticipation is really important too, because it ensures... Everyone has seen it. everyone who just waits till Blu-ray has seen it. You know, everyone has seen it, and the stakes are there so that your box office is insane whenever the conclusion happens.
Right.
But this movie and Captain Marvel are the two that are in between the two Infinity War
And it has a lot to live up to because of that.
And this one even more so because he's already an established character. Captain Marvel could be an origin. I mean, it is an origin film that sets up in the past. Yeah, so
everything you see is going to be new.
Yeah, but this movie definitely had the shadow of Infinity War over it. And I think I already said that. But it definitely lives up to it. So he is basically deciding that his family is more important. While the Pyms are trying to contact Michelle Pfeiffer.
Well, and they're the same thing, where family is more important and they're going after their family, which is basically that quantum realm, you know, basic the storyline where they need to trek into the unknown of
to find Janet.
Because you ended up seeing in the first one that, you know, Scott was able to come back, obviously, and that intrigued them all their own and basically spun off this entire movie, you know. That's pretty much the plot, you know.
Yeah, just to retrieve her from...
Yeah,
the quantum.
They redo some of the scenes from the first one where, you know, it shows them taking out the missile.
Yeah.
That was pretty interesting to see Pfeiffer and Douglas
de-aged again, which is like
crazy.
They look so young.
Yeah, whatever technology they're doing to de-age these actors is like, that deserves a real big kudos because that is freaking crazy. Like, that probably eats into their budget a lot because obviously it's a special effect. But you can, I mean, if they had the budget, they could do like a damn prequel with those two. Well, like
Douglas said he's okay with it. Like,
yeah, and imagine that though. Like, it
can
work.
Is so good that yeah you can have him and some stunt double wearing his face like that, you know.
I know it's a combination of actual makeup
and
then they just fill in a bunch of the
and a double too stuff, I think it's a double
absolutely wild to see, but it's really good.
It looks like you're looking at Michelle Pfeiffer when she does her lines at the beginning, and you're reminded how badass you know Michelle Pfeiffer is as an actress.
Yeah.
But she's like, it looks like she's just stepped off the set of like Batman Returns. Yeah. Her, just like, holy hell.
And they've done it before with Robert Downey Jr. and Kurt Russell.
Yeah, sure.
You know, Guardians and then in Civil War. So
they just can fix everyone, make everyone young. And
you could tell it's something that they're working on to, because now it's Nick Fury's turn in, you know.
Sure, yeah.
Captain Marvel.
So it's one of these things that basically almost expands the lifespan of these actors in the roles.
Yeah. And it's not, and it's something that's really cool because you're able to go back in time. Because one of the things of this movie is these are characters that have had histories with S.H.I.E.L.D. and with everything that has happened before, you know.
Yeah. Right, they're just like in their shadows, in their own little corner too.
Yeah.
The cool thing about the Ant-Man movies, let me just go off on a little tangent here.
Here we go.
Tangent number one.
Speaking of like their own little corner, these Ant-Man movies are very tonally different from like the other flicks. Like what I'm really like saying is that the fact that like, you know, you got really weird elements happening in this movie. Like you have like a whole mini universe happening, you know, and then you have like, you know, ants like as henchmen, like the entire time.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Like just
and I think I told you this. I might have told you this when we exited out the showing the first time, that it feels like one of the most comic book properties, I think.
Yeah.
And you have to be okay with this, basically this world. It is interesting to see, you know, the ants doing all the work and basically all the heavy lifting.
And they're like, a little bit like bigger than your normal ants now. Like they actually have like dog sized ants that are like, you know.
Yeah, and they're trained up to the T. So it's basically like they're henchmen or whatever.
One of them even plays the drums like, you know, twice.
Yeah, and it was funny because watching the trailer, I was like, man, that part looks dumb. But and then you think about it and you're like, whoa. Now it's bonkers. Now it's a little bit more plausible, I guess, because they're able to train these ants, you know, or control them.
I might have said this in the Ant-Man episode that we did, but I remember seeing that Comic-Con footage of him attacking that guy with a gun, mm-hmm. and thinking, man, this is going to be a stupid movie, because I thought this looks too weird or too silly,
it's too out there, yeah.
And this movie, even with all of the talking to ants stuff and insane stuff, is really, really good.
They lean into it. Like, they lean into the craziness of, like, what's actually happening, because you actually have...
And with this fake science that you know.
Well, because you even have a character, I think it's like Paul Rudd at one point, who says, like, you know, do you just put the word quantum in front of everything? Yeah. You know, because they're making fun of themselves there. Like.
And it's the little things where, like, you can tell that they use, like, little pieces. So, like, it's like a knob from, like, an amp, and they blow it up to where, like, yeah. It's super big. So that's, like, the dial they're using. And I'm like, oh, man, that's cool. And it's, like, a dial with, like, a big paper clip.
Yeah,
so it's, like, a huge paper clip. And I'm like, wow, that's, like, super smart.
The building is a fucking suitcase, and yeah. They have a little thing of Hot Wheel cars that blow up.
Yeah, exactly. So I was like, man, like, we've barely scratch the surface of what they can do, you know. And what if there's like an airplane sequence where they're like they're falling out, and then he's able to blow up a jet and they fall in, you know, James Bond style, and they take off or something, you know.
Are you writing a movie, a fan film?
Oh yes,
fanfic, fan porn. Well, that, so let's go down the list of the characters that are new to this movie. So, we'll start with Ghost,
played by Hannah John Kamen,
the Box Ghost,
who I hope I said that right, John Kamen.
Anyway,
she was last seen in Ready Player One this year as one of the henchmen of I forgot his name, Ben Mendelsohn, something. Yeah. I forgot what the villain's name in that movie was, but
Ready Player One out in theaters now.
She was the secondary villain, henchwoman, but if you will, to that, and she was pretty awesome.
She's also a Dothraki.
She was also, yeah, a Dothraki widow in Game of Thrones, which makes her the sixth, I think, actress. Or sixth actor or actress in this, like, you know, from that universe.
From GOT.
Because Game of Thrones actors, they appear kind of regularly in the MCU.
Yep. They just scout him from there. They're like, ooh.
Yeah, it's kind of crazy.
Get on here. Game of what now?
She's really, her role as Ghost is just pretty cool. She's based off, her character is based off of the character of the Ghost in Marvel Comics, which is male and is an Iron Man villain, basically with the same powers. It's not quantum realm powers, but in the comics, the character of Ghost, it's a he. They can go through walls, and they have that weird gas mask like face.
Yeah,
yeah.
Also, we're giving away a ghost pop.
Oh, we are giving a Ghost pop away.
More on that later.
She was pretty. She's pretty awesome in this role because she plays this. Lady named Ava, who's kind of like, you can totally tell she's crying all the time because of the quantum realm does to her. Mm. Like, apparently the ghost in this, the reason she phases in and out of stuff is because her cells are being ripped apart. Like, she was affected by the quantum realm, basically.
And put back together. Yeah, she's got a tragic backstory where she had to watch her parents die because, you know, her dad got fired by Hank Pym on a project. Yeah. So now she's on the vendetta to, one, save herself because she's dying, like she's deteriorating. But two, obviously, it's that revenge, I guess, story to the Hank Pym.
But the way she plays the character is really cool because she seems very evil and almost like kind of there's something off about her. But then you realize that, like, when she starts talking about what's going on, the process of ghosting. Kind of
ghosting,
yeah. The process of ghosting,
of getting ghosted.
They should have called the Ghost Hunters.
Hurts her, so she looks like she's literally like in pain and crying.
They
like all the time.
Should have called the Ghostbusters.
So she's pretty awesome in this role. What's another? Who's another new new
Walter
addition?
Goggins?
Walter Goggins as Sonny Birch.
Sonny Birch,
the arms dealer from the comics.
Yep,
an Iron Man villain again.
Another Iron Man villain.
Quentin Tarantino alumnus.
Tarantino alumnus. Walter Goggins is awesome.
Lawless.
I wish he would have done a little bit more in this movie, but he was pretty good at what he was doing.
Is his character someone from the comic books? Or
yes,
no?
Iron Man villain.
He's an Iron Man villain, or normally tangles with Iron Man. It's a black market like dealer. Same thing goes. I think he's an arms dealer in the comics.
He plays a good southern villain.
Yeah, I like how Ant-Man does say that eventually. He's like, has anybody seen a southern gentleman?
Yeah, around here, yeah.
And then you have Lawrence Fishburne as
Bill Foster.
Bill Foster, a.k.a. Goliath.
They DH him too, I believe.
Yes, they do. Yeah, he looks like he's straight out from Boys in the Hood. And I'm like, damn, this looks awesome.
You know, I read an article, an interview with the director, and he said the scariest thing about de-aging him and Michelle Pfeiffer and even Michael Douglas is these aren't characters that people don't know. These are people you can watch a movie of Michelle Pfeiffer younger.
You remember.
Or Lawrence Fishburne younger or Michael Douglas younger. Yeah. And you have that to compare them to. This isn't like some random, you know, character who just
needs
to be
younger. Kind of intimidating,
But they did such a good job.
They do, yeah. And it's funny because I look at this tech and you're like, man, even in the stuff that they did with like Rogue One with Carrie Fisher, I'm like, that stuff looks like miles like behind from this stuff.
Oh yeah,
which is crazy. Kind of
crazy.
We don't need actors anymore.
Or like Tarkin. Like Tarkin, I'm like, man, why couldn't they use this same one, that this same technology, but for that? But because damn, it looks way fake compared to this stuff.
So that was pretty cool. That Bill Foster makes an appearance, especially the mention of Goliath, which is another name for, which is really another suit. In the Ant-Man universe, you know, you have Yellowjacket, you have Ant-Man, you have Giant Man, and then you have Goliath, which is, I think there's even more, probably, no doubt. But Goliath is one of the Giant Man suits, and they do mention that program from, like, you know, I think the 70s or something like that, which is pretty cool. Another addition would be, who would another new addition be with this? Yeah, Jimmy Woo. Randall Park plays Jimmy Woo. I think we talked a little bit about him. He was in Fresh Off the Boat.
Fresh Off the Boat!
Jimmy Woo is a comic character. Is a character from the comics who starts like a superhero spy team called like the Agents of Atlas.
Boom.
Which is pretty cool.
Yeah. And then he's also, he's got a charming sense of humor, I think.
Yeah. And he's pretty great.
He's just hilarious. Yeah. And like you can tell he has to float the line between bad guy and like good guy, but he does it very well. He's a very likable character, I think, in pretty much anything he's in.
Right, yeah. And then we got the big one, really. I mean, I guess...
Michelle Pfeiffer.
Yeah. I guess we can go ahead and just, like, start there. Have Michelle Pfeiffer.
Well, they show some of her... Not her, but some of the Wasp in the first Ant-Man movie. Yeah. But we don't actually see her face. So clever. They could have classed it.
Very clever.
They could have classed it. They could have casted anyone. Really.
Mm-hmm.
But...
Yeah, I think at one point... which is really funny. Some trivia. Yeah, no. Some trivia is, like... Evangeline Lilly, who plays Hope Van Dyne, the Wasp in this movie, she said that she wanted to have Michelle Pfeiffer cast as the Wasp eventually. This was around the time they were doing press for the first movie. Michael Douglas said that he would like to have his wife, Catherine Zeta-Jones, play the Wasp. I thought she could probably do a good job. I was like, oh yeah, I can see it too. It's just really funny how they kind of like chose Pfeiffer for it, but
yeah,
Pfeiffer did a really good job at this.
Yeah,
coming off of what is it, Mother,
Dark Shadows? No, Mother.
What?
Well, she's not. I mean, after we see her for a lot of the movie, I felt, man, I can't wait for a whole movie with her.
It's just so,
she's really smart, right? Like her character is now also a god or something.
Well, yeah, and then also the fact is that her character itself, and this is just like, I'm going to echo something that Hope Van Dyne said in the first movie. It's about damn time. She's Janet fucking Van Dyne. Like, Janet Van Dyne.
Janet Van Dyne?
Janet Van Dyne. The Janet Van Dyne.
Oh, my God. From the Catalina wine mixer?
Janet Van Dyne, obviously, we've said it earlier, is the fucking Wasp in the comics. Like, she's like, she's one of the founding members of the Avengers. Like, you know, you see her in everything Avengers-related almost except the movies, which is, like, really weird for, like, you know, even for, like, me and Andrew, like, watching the you know, Avengers cartoon and being familiar with, like, the earlier comics, like Marvel Zombies and stuff that we you know, kind of turned us on to Marvel. It was bizarre to not see an actual active Wasp character in these movies.
The Avengers you got, like, the Avengers you currently get, both in comics and in the movies and cartoons, are very modern Avengers. Because, again, John's right, that she is a very pivotal character for the Avengers Inception with Hank Pym. They're kind of the original almost power couple, you know?
Yeah, so to get that in this movie, it's pretty awesome. And then you also get like a new incarnation of them with Scott Lang and Hope's character.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So that's what, like, to me, that's what was really cool about this movie is the fact that, like, you know, that you have Janet Van Dyne played by Michelle Pfeiffer, who knocks it out of the park. Like, she's, I don't know why she doesn't get, or maybe I'm just not watching enough of her movies, maybe. But I was like,
John.
Last one she was should Mother, be in, right? Like, way more. Yeah, she was great
in
Mother.
She's in Mother?
She's in Mother. She was great in Mother.
Yeah, I thought she should have got a nomination.
Academy Award supporting nod for that one. Yeah, so she rounds out basically the new cast here. And then we get into, like, really the fun stuff, which is an actual, like, pairing up of, like, after a quick introduction to Scott's life, we realize that he's has a connection to Janet's character.
Yeah, he sees her.
Yeah,
or sees the things sees.
Well, I think he's kind of like mentally linked with her.
He becomes her.
Basically, yeah.
I said that weird.
But, and then we're reintroduced to Pym and and Hope's character.
Yeah.
Which were like, you know, they kind of hate Scott.
But they've been working towards this forever.
Right, exactly. Yeah.
And now Scott is the key. They want what's in his head.
Well, yeah, and then he was also proof that you can come back. So yeah. They're like, oh, you know, maybe she survived. Need her.
Let's talk about Hope's character, played by Evangeline Lilly. I read somewhere that she had very specific things that she wanted to do with her character that the director definitely agreed on. One of the things is something I noticed. It's kind of weird, but there were scenes in the movie, and I was like, man, her hair is messed up. But I don't know if you noticed that. But yeah. That was on purpose. She said she didn't want... Because she did a lot of her own stunts in this movie. Yeah. She said she hates in action movies where the girl character gets in a fight and then everything is perfect. The makeup is perfect. So she says, after I do this stunt, we're going to film... Like, you know, this is... Yeah, whatever is there, this is like the way it is.
Well, and it's awesome because, I mean, obviously they try to...
And I don't like it.
Try to minimize the variation by because she always puts her hair into a ponytail when she puts the suit on.
But it's cool because it just shows the almost this weird reality to how messy her job is, which is she fights people.
And it's the same thing with her fighting style. She said that it was really tough trying to come up with a specific fighting style because so much groundwork has already been laid down by, you know, other characters. Yeah. Like, you know, Black Panther fights a certain way.
She got,
Scarlet Witch, Black Widow, Captain America.
You got Black Widow, wrap around the head.
You got Wonder Woman stuff.
Yeah, Wonder Woman. Like, so it's so hard.
Wonder Woman?
Yeah, I'm just saying, she's crossing over. But it's so hard to again distinguish and make her stand out,
but she shrinks too, so yeah, come on.
Right. And well, and then she said she looked to the comics and she said back in the day that they were just over sexualized, like her moves, you know, just because she was, you know,
That was a character created by like men, basically,
right?
Like,
yeah,
there are people who go to these movies thinking that same.
Yeah, exactly. Mm-hmm. Which I'm glad that
I'm just kidding.
I'm glad that she chooses to evolve this character like that because she said, obviously, she's doing her research and she's trying to stay true to the comics, but also, again,
bring it out of a stereotype.
Sure, and mush it forward.
And in a way that she is one of the, I mean, obviously, Scott Lang is the main character, but she's, this is really close to being her movie.
Yeah.
Because it's a search for her mom.
Yeah.
Definitely. I think I want to say that maybe I think she has a little bit even more action time than Scott.
Yeah.
In this movie.
She definitely does.
And it works remarkably well. Like in the comics, she flies around with these wings and she uses these little blasters like on her hands. They kept that. Like I didn't think they were going to keep the blaster part, which is really, really cool.
She throws shit all. Yeah.
Yeah, she throws shit out of her like little blasters and she also like, you know, she can shrink stuff. She throws the shrinking and those little enlarging discs.
Well, Scott, the majority of this movie, she's the driver of the plot.
Right.
Really, exactly. Because Scott is always he's juggling so many things, his home life, him needing to be
his end game is his home life though.
Yeah, like, to that's be home. Stuff, yeah. The business that needs to take off.
Well, and I think
he feels bad about the pimps.
His end game is his family. And I think he's trying to make the Wasp his family. And I think that's basically it. Like, you know, he needs a partner.
Yeah.
You know?
They talk about that.
They keep talking about it.
Even says in the film, like, if I was with you
in Civil War, then you probably wouldn't have gotten away.
Which I definitely believe. Because, for sure.
Well, apparently they were like actually dating. Like that's what it sounded like.
Oh my God, were they like dating?
Well, that's because she said there were other stuffing together, and then, like, you know...
Stuffing together.
I knew you guys were going to take that away from it, but, like...
Like some cornbread in a turkey's ass.
You stuffed her like a Thanksgiving turkey.
Anyway, they were doing that, so, like, she really does feel, kind of pissed and betrayed by Scott, like, going off to help Captain America. Because
And Hank, too, right? And, like, he took his suit.
Yeah, exactly.
I did love that part about the movie, was that, like, because of his actions in Civil War, they were on the run. So it kind of added to the atmospheres that they couldn't stay in one place for long. So they needed to have everything that was mobile. Someone told me, they're like, I didn't like I think it was Clayton. This is for you, Clayton. I know you're listening. Anyway, he said he didn't like the fact that everyone was racing for the lab. But I think it was kind of cool because, again, they need to have everything that's portable and things like that. And, of course, they got creative. One of my favorite shots is when they're in the woods and they shrink down the lab, but there's a bunch of FBI agents behind them, it.
It's a literal MacGuffin.
Yeah.
Yeah, definitely.
Yeah, most definitely.
A MacGuffin is a muffin from McDonald's. so you guys know. And we love it. That's why we call everything a MacGuffin.
Exactly.
Because we like it.
Everyone chases it, too.
Yeah. Yeah. So
I'm just kidding. It's a Hitchcock thing. Look it up.
Is it really?
Yeah, I think so.
Maybe. Look it up right now.
MacGuffin wouldn't be a McDonald's thing. So.
Yeah. It is a muck.
Yeah, a muffin. MacGuffin.
It's you, a muffin.
Do you guys think that, what was the purple guy from McDonald's?
Grimace.
Do you think he ever got, like, laid?
The Infinity Stones?
Do you think Grimace got laid?
Do you think Grimace got laid?
Let us know in the comments.
Yeah, exactly.
Who was the girl in the McDonald's thing?
Yeah.
The pigtail.
Yeah, that was a...
The Hamburglar. The Hamburglar, Grimace.
Ronald McDonald, and then no one remembers the other one.
Big Bird. I'm kidding. Anyways, let us know. Let us know. Tweet us.
For Grimace.
Tweet us all of the cast of McDonald's and find out where they are now.
Boom.
Because they're also superheroes. You know what? I'm going to vote for Disney to buy McDonald's. Because we got to see those guys
in a
Marvel movie. But yeah, so there's a lot of really critical parts of this movie is great. But I love that it really just boils down to family, and it must be one of the hardest things to follow the tone of Infinity War with a movie this light and this fun and the stakes that are pretty low.
I feel like they're low, but they're also very. It very does tie into what all these stakes in these bigger movies are about, because like if you're fighting to save the world, you're obviously fighting to save people you don't know because you know they're suffering.
We're all family.
We are
family.
Let's participate. Like, hey. Hands across America.
You save the world or you save stuff so that your friends and family can be safe. Like,
yeah, ultimately.
First and foremost. And this movie emphasizes that. Big time, really.
The reason why...
Big time, no pun intended.
Because even Bill Foster's trying to save Ghost because of, like, you know...
He's kind of like an adopted father.
Yeah, kind of like an adopted father to that character.
Mm-hmm.
So, like, it's still really cool.
And it's funny that we say it's the father-son thing, because in this one, it's the daughter-father.
And then mother.
Yeah, you get...
Daughter-mother.
You get Scott's daughter.
Father-daughter.
You get Hank Pym and the Wasp, and then you get, Bill Foster, which is Goliath and Ghost... So it's pretty awesome. I like it. I like all these
shifts. What did you think about his prison gang and
prison gang them, T.I.
There, I mean, there's a lot of comic relief in this, but they are
definitely really
funny.
Really funny.
They are. Movie. They're really. I think they're a little better here than they were in the first movie.
Baba
which
Yaga,
is pretty great. Yeah.
How great was that truth serum thing?
That bit
with the way that, wasn't it Michael Pena? What's his name?
Michael Pena.
Michael Pena and his titular explaining of a story.
Yeah.
But to have it be. You know, what can make this better is give him truth serum and have him, you know, describe a ton of stuff that way.
Yeah, yeah, I know. And I think everybody was waiting for it.
Yeah.
And so I, as soon as you heard the drums, it was to the point where they were, you know, everyone kind of started to cheer.
Yeah.
So that was pretty awesome because, you know, they made so many memes and videos about things like that too.
Well, it's a really clever montage. And it reminds me of almost like Drunk History style where
I think
people are mouthing the things that
You guys don't think it's really interesting that that's probably like an Edgar Wright thing that they just poured over into
that is
the sequel?
But
like,
yeah, it's good.
It's good.
Yeah, if it's good, just keep it, which is pretty cool.
I think when you think about these Marvel movies and what makes them their own, and this is one of the things you throw into Ant-Man as being kind of a motif.
Now it's just like dancing in
80s movies is like a
Guardians thing.
Thor Ragnarok thing. I was kidding.
Oh.
But I think that's one of the Ant-Man things of the movie.
He's messing with the...
It's okay.
He's literally looking at it, and I was like, I heard you.
We're recording this in the living room, and my dog likes to eat wires.
Yeah.
So
but
he's
fine.
Eating all the equipment.
Because he poops batteries, and it's very economical for us. Yeah.
He's like that dog Axel.
Oh, he shit a car battery out once, and it was great. We got to put some of those jumpers on our nips later.
Ooh, cool. He's like Nibbler from Futurama.
Yeah. Let's talk about the quantum realm for a little bit. Since you guys are no comic books, does this have any connection at all to Thanos? Or I know the quantum realm and all the things we explored means power, because Michelle Pfeiffer can heal people now.
Yeah.
But what is there that may be important to... I mean, I know it's a lot of power, but what is it enough power or more power or less power than the Infinity Gauntlet? Or is that where we're going to send Thanos?
I actually don't know a lot about the Quantum Realm in the comics or if it is a big thing in the comics.
I think it
is actually more based in like real science of like, you know, you know, what happens if you keep getting smaller and smaller? You know, half of the half of the half of the half.
Yeah. Yeah.
Well, and it's the inner space thing. They have a video called Powers of 10 or whatever where it'll show you like, oh, we live, like here's a, you know, the skin cells, and then it goes out 10, you know.
To the galaxy.
Yeah, exactly. And then it goes in. So it shows you that basically in a cell, it's built like a galaxy, you know? Yeah. So you start to go in and...
Wow.
So there's this whole other universe.
It's like the end of Men in Black 2.
Yeah, yeah.
Oh, wait, 3. Was that the one with the aliens in the locker room?
I think that was the Men in Black 2. 1. Was that Men in Black 1?
Maybe. Yeah, I think that might have been 1. Or, so the quantum realm is in the comics. It's called the Microverse.
Microverse.
It's basically the same thing.
Yeah, that would have been a stupid name if they called it that.
Yeah.
Yeah, and that's basically the worlds within worlds within worlds within worlds type of theory.
Exactly. So there's some shit going on in there.
Yeah, and so it's basically, the microverse is basically only accessible through shrinking, and that's basically what they deal with. That's the name they deal with in the comics. This one, the quantum realm, is pretty much maybe visually different because obviously they have to do something a little different for that. I think it's awesome. I don't know if it's too much related to Infinity War stuff as it is to Doctor Strange stuff because it's the microverse.
Multiverse, yeah.
Yeah, the microverse is basically a different universe. So, like, the quantum realm is its own little universe. So I think it has potential going forward to kind of cross into stuff like Doctor Strange and maybe Captain Marvel. I heard that there's a rumor that it's going to play some sort of role in the upcoming Captain Marvel film. I'm not sure if that's true or not, but, I mean, I feel like that's where it can go. Yeah. As far as, like, Infinity War stuff, I don't know, maybe. They do mention towards the end, and we'll talk more about that specific scene towards the end, but in that scene, they do mention a time vortex, which I got some Doctor Who vibes out of it because, you know, the time vortex is that circular tunnel that the Doctor travels through.
Yeah. Well, when he does shrink down, it is kind of a similar sequence even than Doctor Strange when he goes through all of those different experimental dimensions. We see cells and what's inside of cells, and then what we interpret is inside of that. It's insane, and I think it just adds to another pretty complicated layer of the Marvel Cinematic Universe.
Yeah. And the fact that you're only doing it in this movie is really kind of unique because you're at least so far, because like you're not really getting any explanation in any other movie. Yeah. Like, so,
like, this is it. This is the
right exactly. This is where we see it. This is where you learn from it, and then I want to just talk about it visually. It looks kind of very, very, very trippy.
Which it looks really expensive. Cool. That's what it looks like.
Yeah, it does. Yeah.
For real.
It is an expensive place, this quantum realm. Because
things are shaking. Now, I don't know, are there no beings?
You can almost like see sound, because it almost looks like everything there is like almost like sound frequency.
Are there
like,
things just, like, in there other than humans, or no?
There's a mention again at the end where like Janet's character, Pfeiffer's character,
learned or whatever.
She says like, you know, don't step near a specific something, because it will eat you.
Interesting,
and
because
it's just kind of weird.
Like, she got that shirt from somewhere.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, and so she and she was like, she's kind of like a almost like a like a Mad Max type of like character, like wandering.
They're pushing the envelope of what will fit into the ethos of Marvel. Because if you think about it, there's the galaxy, there's all of these dimensions.
Well, yeah,
and all you have this crazy tiny thing happening.
It's the same thing where it's that Powers of 10. We're like, yeah, we zoom out, we got Guardians of the Galaxy.
Yeah,
but we zoom in, and this is where Ant-Man
here.
And only when there's a threat for all of that will they need some insane thing. But can you imagine an Ant-Man movie that takes place majority of the time in someone's dick? Whoops.
Right, exactly.
Something small.
Yeah, see, exactly. They can pull some Osmosis Jones-like shit. Ooh.
Yeah,
like, where, like, hey, go in there and, like, you know,
the Fantastic Voyage.
Did Ron Howard make Osmosis Jones?
Yeah, you did.
We did talk about that, right?
We did.
Yeah, exactly.
I loved Osmosis Jones, guys.
Boom. I loved Anatomy Park, Rick and Morty.
I watched both of those things, but I watched one of them in school for health class, and I was like, this is awesome. This is what all... We should learn all science through movies.
Yeah. Windrix.
And we watched Flubber in science class, too. Yeah. Man, that was... There's no science in that, is there?
No.
Uh-oh. Ooh, boy, too soon. Do your Robin Williams impression.
The hot dog?
Nice.
Remember, boom. You couldn't see it, but it was good. Mrs. Doubtfire. Yep. Get out.
Guys, we're going to take another break. When we return, we'll talk a little bit more about... No trivia game.
Oh, ooh.
Sorry. We're going to wait until the Blu-ray. We'll have a trivia game later. But we'll take a little break, and when we return, we'll finish up our thoughts on this beautiful movie, Ant-Man and the Wasp. Bzzz.
This is the situations. I'm back to bases in. I'm kind of stingy, that's why
I don't. Maybe. I mean, it's half of all life in the universe.
Is it?
All life.
Wait, it's all life?
Yeah, all
plants.
Life.
Plants. Some of the plants.
So we went from like 10 pandas to 5?
Yeah, exactly.
That's bullshit.
That's kind of crazy, right? Like, so Thanos
that's
is just
bougie.
Like...
You know...
There was 2 elephants, now there's 1.
We haven't done our Jurassic World 2 episode yet, but I just want to say one thing. They can... I'll say 2 things. They can clone anything, and they keep cloning dinosaurs. They could clone anything.
Dragons. Are we going to do a Jurassic World episode?
Oh,
man,
yeah.
That movie
oh, for
is
sure.
Like, holy hell.
And also, they
that
have
movie
a,
is bonkers
they have
weird.
A gun that they can point at a person to tell a dinosaur
to kill it, yeah.
But when you have a gun pointed at someone, just...
Shoot him with a gun.
Shoot him with a gun you already have pointed at them. Right?
Why do you need to, like...
Why do you need to maybe mess up?
No, they can trace this bullet back to us. They can't
just,
trace the dinosaur back
just
to us.
Fucking insane.
Everyone has dinosaurs. They will not be able to trace that raptor back to us.
They can trace a bullet. Just, fuck that, though.
I know. Is that the point is to be like, it just fucking raptor attack, bro? Anyways, welcome back to Ant-Man and the Wasp / Jurassic World 2. Good dinosaur pointing. Oh, boy.
Booey.
Let's keep talking about Ant-Man. What's an ant and what's a man?
Oh, I don't think you
take.
Want, you do not want to come to this podcast for
I thought
that
this,
definition.
I thought Ant-Man was spelled AUNT/MAN, and I thought it was a... Mrs. Doubtfire type situation.
And then your ideas basically was almost confirmed when you heard that Paul Rudd was in this movie.
Yeah,
like, oh
yeah.
He does sound like an ant.
Hey,
man.
Guys, Paul Rudd, keeping it tight, keeping it right. Am I right? Keeping it fit,
what
keeping
are you talking
it
about?
Lit.
Oh, I know what you seen
talking
at the
about
beginning.
His hot bod.
Yeah.
Keeping it ripe.
Mm. It's so weird. I think they have an obligatory like shirtless
but
TBH, male Marvel
they
shot,
showed him from the side,
weird.
Though.
Yeah.
They showed him from the side and not straight up.
How sweet is his bod?
He's like 50.
No, I saw him in This Is 40. He's 40. Because This Is 40.
Yeah, oh, I think I saw a movie.
Apatow was lying.
This Is 50.
Yeah, I saw a trailer for that Mila Kunis. What's the girl that trailer that came out? She's like, we're in our 30s. And I was like, you're not in your 30s.
Oh,
you fucking liar.
You were a teenager during the 70s.
Yeah.
I think you're like 60. I think you're 70
that's
years
what you're
old.
Hanging out down the street.
The same old thing. But yeah, what else do you guys want to talk about?
So,
go ahead.
Kind
John.
Of the
so, like,
the giant man appearance in this movie is pretty wild. Actually,
what about the little man one? Where
yeah, I guess
in,
that
in
one
the
too. Yeah,
also.
The regulator
that gave me flashbacks of Deadpool too. A little when he's
the
a baby
legs.
Yeah,
and I think it's pretty cool. Like the way you said earlier, like it kind of makes.
Oh yeah.
Uh-huh. The it makes sense earlier when you said like you know. Yeah. Basically, that like, what did you say? What it says? It's basically
this
like
little
the
man one where he said the baby legs.
Well, the baby leg stuff, but it's also like what Delphin said earlier about being like you know having size difference anyway. Like you know, it's comedic. Like you know, you see like a giant salt shaker get like, you know, it's over. You know, it's strong. It's becomes huge, and then it knocks out a person. You're just like kind of like, yeah, okay, cool. And then at one point, there's a Pez dispenser that's like blown up to like a giant, like weapon.
Yeah, that's interesting.
That's not an ant.
That's Spider-Man, man, bro.
Emmanuel encountered a spider right now. He just wanted to go kill it.
Okay.
Now it's cool. We're talking about bugs.
Yeah, boom. We're talking about ants.
This whole movie is about a bug man.
Huge spider.
How big was the spider?
It was like at least the size of a dollar.
It was at least the size of a dollar.
Of a what?
Of a dollar
bill.
No. It's like this big.
It's a dollar.
Yeah, that's a silver dollar.
A dollar is like
dollar
6
bill.
Inches long.
You're thinking like spiders aren't square.
It was a fucking like, tarantula.
Yeah. Spider-Man.
Wide spider.
Boom.
Ants.
But yeah, I think you're right, John, on that whole subject matter, I guess, in general.
What are you talking about? Like, just like being like, it just looks funny when things get big and small.
Yeah, well, and that's where I think they haven't.
Like this dick.
Nice. I think that's something that they haven't explored a lot all the way. They did with the little building stuff and the Hot Wheels thing and the Pez a little bit, but I think it can go so much further.
Oh, yeah.
So
they,
much further.
Well, that's they did that whole. I think that's where you brought it back
like,
around.
When
too.
He was a giant, like Giant Man, I would have just made a burrito huge and just like, eat this. And then now he's got energy.
Oh, yeah. Or, like,
you know,
eat
like
this,
that.
All of starving everyone.
Yeah.
Boom, fixed, hunger.
Like, I'm ready I'm ready to see, like, full-on, like, kaiju fight or him work with Wakanda to be like, hey, yeah, here's this drop of water. Boom.
They can take over the world. For every one person, there's probably a million ants, and they just have to make them all big, and boom. Welcome to War of the Planet of the Ants.
Boom, ants.
I guess it shows, like, the weirdness of why, I mean, how isolated, like, Pym is to the rest of the world, though. Because, like, it does show, I mean, you've already hinted at one point that Pym fired some dude's or some girl's father.
But he said that he was a traitor.
Well, that's the weird thing tech. Because
you're not sure whose side.
Exactly. Because he says that kind of like, you know, in a rage.
Yeah.
And like, and he says that in a rage, and then he kind of like, which is kind of weird, he's like, Bill Foster's filling that girl's head with lies, even though you literally saw a scene before that full of exposition that,
you
like...
You know he's not.
He's not doing that at all, which is, like, really funny, because, like... And then I think that's a hint to the actual... Maybe an homage to the actual character that Hank Pym is, which is, like, you know, he's kind of got a lot of secrets, like, a lot of skeletons in his
closet.
You
know what's weird, though, is he's not... Is he apologetic at all at this movie? He's
really not.
No, he's like, I'm sorry, I fucked all these scientists up. Oh, well, let me get my girl.
Or even then, he's like, you never apologize. He's like, no, he just fires the best people. He's like, yeah, I fire mediocrities or something like that. Like,
he's like,
just,
sorry, your name wasn't on the side of the building. Mine was get the book out.
Yeah, he's basically that person.
Which is weird because I think that was maybe a way for him to have some kind of redemption. But you're right. A lot of the times I was wondering whose side was I supposed to be on. I gave you too much whiskey.
This is a huge glass of whiskey he just poured me, guys.
Well,
like
John.
A giant glass of whiskey.
Like my hero, William Jefferson Cosby once said.
Oh my God!
Fill it up.
You're cutting that, right?
Nope, leaving it in.
Anyway, go on.
But yeah, I think that we don't see a lot of him being the way he, I guess, he is in the comic books. It's a dark turn to make, and this movie is very light. But at some point, he should deal with it as a character.
I think
that would be the next time they CGI him younger. It should be him. Like the way he was in the lab, maybe he was actually awful.
That's why he needs the beauty to tame the beast. It's just like Black Widow and the Hulk. Boom, sun's getting real low.
So yeah, so I guess Janet's his beauty then. I guess just kind of like calms him down.
Oh no, Michael Douglas is the beauty.
Oh yeah.
Oh my bad.
Well, I'm excited to see that dynamic because you're right. They were the power couple of that time. We got a little hint of that in this movie of them working together, and it seems like she's a little smarter than him, too.
Oh, yeah, definitely. Yeah, which is really cool.
And that scene where she takes over Scott, hilarious.
Oh, yeah.
That was too funny.
Super funny. It was a little weird, but yeah. Super cute.
I love the fact that, like, Douglas's character, Pym, is actually loving this. Like, he's kind of, like, he's going with it. And it cuts back to Evangeline Lilly, like, as Hope. And she's, like, she's kind of touched by what's going on at times, but for the majority she's kind of staring at him like kind of weird, like this is a weird moment between all three of us. And Pym is like just completely infatuated by what's going on, like he's like smiling and he keeps his hand held like with Scott. It just looks really funny.
Yeah, I don't know
okay.
I don't know how he did that. I mean, I'm sure he's a funny actor, Paul.
They probably had, like, delivery. No doubt that they probably had, like, you know, Michelle Pfeiffer say the lines or maybe just record them, and then he probably, like, tried his best to, like...
acted the way she acted.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, really, really funny. And I think that's what's good about Paul Rudd is he has great comedic timing.
Yeah, definitely.
There are times that need to be awkward that he makes awkward, and then there's times for him to be super sincere, and he is. Like, when he asked for the juice box in the car or the van.
Oh, yeah.
And that's what was funny, not because he was goofing off, but he was genuinely... But I think that just the best dynamic in the movie is him and his daughter. It's just so good.
Him and his daughter and him and Hope. Yeah. Like, I think him and Hope are really...
Paul Rudd would be a great dad, huh?
Paul Rudd, yeah, would be a great dad.
I want him to be my daddy.
And that magic stuff where he's like, I went to the length
forgot
of
about
this,
the magic.
Of this magic. And then everyone's like, how you do that?
And then the FBI agent who's like... Magic.
What's the guy's name? Bobby Knievel? Bobby Knievel or something?
Yeah, he was funny. Inside this.
He's hilarious. He had a huge role in the first one, obviously. Like, he was, like, basically almost one of the antagonists.
The rivals,
In this one, he's just almost, like, basically a glorified cameo. Yeah, and literally all hugs.
He has kind of a weird joke that he always says is when the ex-wife would be like, well, you can't do this, and he kept saying, they can.
Yeah.
I don't know. That was weird to me. I was like,
ice.
He's a policeman, but yeah, I was like, oh, that's
kind of
weird.
I think it's weird because that first time it happens, they cut away. You think there's going to be more to the scene, and they kind of cut away as soon as they're
and
like...
he says it two more times.
Yeah.
And I was like, is this supposed to be a comment? Is this, hey, is this political?
Yeah,
nice. Because then I'm not, I don't like it. Leave politics out of movies about ants. That's all I ask for. When I watch Ants with when Woody Allen is in it, political. When I watch A Bug's Life and there are carnies in it.
And there's...
They're trying to get us to like carnies?
Yeah, oh, fat-shaming Heimlich.
There's the, both those movies are political now that you
political.
Think about it.
Fuck. Well, the movie Them from the 30s about the gigantic...
Hey, they're watching that at the end of this movie.
That was super political. I mean, yeah. That's all about radiation. Yeah. And radiation, stuff. Yeah. But yeah, too political. That's all I want, Hollywood.
Leave ants alone.
Leave ants out of it, okay? there are no red ants or blue ants, although there are.
Yeah,
I, mean, I think there are red ants.
I think they're all red in this movie, yeah.
What else? What
Some
else?
Of them are black. So the ants in this movie, how about the ants themselves? They make some
great
really
characters.
Cool
they didn't have one. I guess the one in the house that was playing copying him was the
playing
funny
the drums.
One. But I'm glad they didn't name them because the scene with the seagulls.
They did
oh,
name
he
them.
He was naming them.
Yeah.
When they were dying,
Antoinette,
that made me so sad.
Antoinette, Antonio Banderas.
And they kept Anton. Dying.
Anton. There was another one where he. Man, he tells Wasp, he's like, did you like that name?
Mark
this
Antony?
Is S. Ger-Ant.
Ger-Ant. Yeah.
That's it.
That was a little lame, boom. Actually. That was a good one. That one was lame.
Ants.
Ants.
Well, even Giant Man is literally Giant Man.
Well, they made a big deal in the first one to talk about the different ants, but in this one, they're just like,
whatever. Just ants.
Oh, we have a ton of fucking ants.
Yeah.
They established them already with those.
They're all worker bee ants.
And it's just weird because they have this whole army of gigantic ants.
Yeah,
and they use them to they use them to imprison people sometimes, but they never use them to kill ghosts because they could have fucking snapped her head in half at any point. But and what did you think about that scene where Ghost or Lawrence Fishburne's character made the daughter off limits for Ghosts?
Oh yeah, he's like, don't
Remember
touch
that?
Her.
And I was like, damn, that was a pretty
that's pretty
heavy
crazy
scene.
And pretty strong. And like, I feel like that's what kind of speaks to the family nature of this movie,
and
because
it,
like
it literally,
you can almost make this an actual family friendly film. Like,
but
you could probably
it shows
watch this with
you, it shows you where they draw the line.
That's why I believe Fishburne's character more than Pim's.
Yeah.
Oh yeah, definitely. And it seems like he probably
he's nicer.
Is, yeah, the, probably the nicer of
well,
the two.
Well, and
yeah.
Everybody's after like besides I guess Sonny or whatever. Everyone's after their own interests, which is you know good essentially.
Do you think, well, let's talk about the Stan Lee cameo, then we can talk about where this thing goes. What do you think about that Stan Lee cameo? Pretty sad, considering the actual state of Stan Lee's life.
Jesus Christ.
Right?
We got real dark.
I mean, anyways, we'll
He's
talk
like,
about
I don't remember
no,
the
I mean,
60s.
I think so. I think that was it was a really cool cameo. I think the delivery of the line landed the first time for me.
Stan Lee's line?
Then
Stan Lee's line?
The second time, I thought it was awkward.
He's like, second time, I just didn't believe his
well,
performance.
No, because the way it's just said is like, oh, man, I had fun in the 60s, but now I'm paying for it. And I was like, that's kind of, okay.
Yeah. But you know that's one of 20 that he did that
Baby
day.
Boomers.
Right? And then it just kind of makes you wonder why they chose that one instead of the other, like, 19. But it was a really cool cameo. It makes it seem like, you know,
John hated
he's been
this
on
cameo.
Drugs. It makes it seem like he's been on drugs, I guess. That's what
Which I don't know if he's on drugs.
Yeah, so.
Like, I don't know. I don't want to say anything like
ibuprofen.
That. Ibuprofen. That's a drug, technically.
Tylenol.
Everyone's
he
on
He said
drugs.
He had fun in the 60s, just creating a bunch of comic characters.
Yeah, he was like, alive. Yeah. He just got back from the fucking war.
Yeah, exactly. By the way, when this airs, we lost someone kind of dear to the Marvel Universe. I just kind of wanted to say it now.
Okay.
Or should we say it during the plugs?
Oh, that the artist.
Yeah, Steve Ditko passed away.
How old was he? He must have been really old.
90.
At the age of 90, yeah.
He was very old.
But he's famous for creating... For literally drawing Spider-Man and Doctor Strange, which is
yeah, he's the OG writer artist
artist yeah. So like
OG
that kind of,
triple OG
RIP triple OG. It was how many? So Marvel original. How many people were there? There were not so that many people there.
Jack ones, Kirby, Stan Lee. That's it.
Jack Kirby, Stan Lee, and Ditko. Really, I mean, those are the kind of the big three ones that the and John Romita Sr.
Senior.
So like John Romita Sr.
I hate John Romita Jr.
Ditko,
I do, for real.
Really? Okay.
Ditko, Kirby. Art. So like, but Ditko, I mean, if anyone loves Spider-Man or Doctor Strange, like he created that look. Like he's the one who drew that. So like, you know, that's really awesome.
Benedict Cumberbatch?
Super,
he drew him.
Super, Yeah, I mean, it's super sad that he passed. But yeah,
he lived a long life.
Yes, lived a long, fruitful life. And rest in peace.
I think he did something that a lot of people want, is make a legacy that withstands
the test of time.
The test of time.
Right. He didn't get paid too much for it, but like no one will ever forget his characters.
Well, you see inflation.
And that's what this podcast is. It's our legacy.
Oh, it's like, I mean, yeah, we wouldn't be doing this podcast without him, so.
Yes. Yes.
Yeah. Yes.
Yes. Queen. Wig. What else do you guys know from RuPaul's Drag Race? The library is open. Do you guys know that?
No.
That means we can throw shade because, wait, shades don't have nothing to
lie with. Yeah.
Ooh, shades. Character in Luke Cage, Boom. Season 2.
Man, all right. Marvel's killing it. Let's talk about where this goes from now. So Ant-Man, well, let's talk about the ending, I guess.
Oh, my God.
That big battle. All that battle.
Oh, yeah, you're right. Never mind.
Wasp we just back, and then the giant man stuff happens.
I think that's pretty self-explanatory, though.
Like, it's a good battle. Well, here's the other thing. I mean, before we go into the end, the mid-credit, but is there a possibility that Ghost and Fishburne
return?
Maybe. Does she still have powers? I think so. Or is she just a human? I think
it's minimal powers. Now.
I think she still has powers. I mean, they're kind of – the end-credit scene kind of – it's doing that to help her. Like, they go into the quantum realm.
Wait, it gets
we'll get there, but, like, you know, particles.
She needs the meds.
Yeah, so, like, you know, they're working on something for her. And I think, like, to bring it back to what we said earlier, like, I think it's really cool that Ghost... I think it's cool that Ghost kind of, like, you know, becomes this, like, non-villain at the very end. It's a little sudden and a little kind of, like...
It's weird.
Maybe a little weird.
She gets thrown to, like, the side, and everyone has a happy reunion, and they literally look over, and they're like, oh, shit.
Yeah, and I guess that's why, though, because you've had that happy ending, like, for everybody else, and this chick is just, like, suffering really, really bad.
It makes me really sad.
Yeah, and so, like, but to have, like, Janet kind of heal her with her weird godlike powers.
That's true, too. Like, she's probably one of the most powerful...
Yeah, Avengers now.
Yeah, she has legit... healing powers. Yeah.
Or ripping, like, you don't know what else she can do with that. I mean, she can probably rip them apart, too.
Didn't last long, am I right?
Oh, yeah, I guess so. Yeah.
Also, I thought it was kind of cool that Michael Douglas got to put on a suit in this one.
Yeah.
He almost looked like a classic. If you guys noticed, the way the helmet,
he kind of dons a classic look, because most of his original helmet kind of was showed, you know, you saw a lot of his face. So it was pretty interesting to see him and... Michelle Pfeiffer suit up too, so you saw basically two generations of the Wasp and, you know, Ant-Man.
Even the colors, they're gray and red, which is kind of like one of the original, like, Ant-Man colors.
Yeah, it's pretty awesome.
All they really needed was, like, and I thought they were going to do this, which would have been dumb but cool at the same time, but a little bit more dumb. I thought they were going to have antlers out of his helmet, because I was like, that's literally what the original Ant-Man helmet looks like.
Yeah.
Because it's just like a little outline over his face, and then... antlers.
I'm actually surprised
at or antenna, my bad.
I'm actually surprised as to how many people they were able to get involved in the final act. They got pretty much everybody, like, everybody needs to do something.
I guess that's why they use Walter Goggins' character a little bit too much.
They needed him.
Yeah, because I was like, I was kind of wondering what he was doing there for so long, because, like, they didn't ever reveal his source or whatever, like, you know, the people that he was working for. Maybe that's like a
Hydra.
Maybe maybe that's like a seed for a future movie.
Yeah. He doesn't die. But they give him the truth serum and
that truth serum part was hilarious also.
I guess so. Like they had to have that part, so they have, you know, so they can have Michael Pena and T.I. and David Dalmastian involved. Yeah,
was good. He's like that beloved commercial that no one remembers it.
Fun fact though about the car chase in this movie. Me and Drew, actually, we were talking about it. There is an actual, from Edgar Wright's original Ant-Man script. We don't know if this is true or not, but, like, I think it's interesting that Edgar Wright's original script had a car chase scene, and that was not in the original Ant-Man movie.
Boom. Mm. It ended up becoming Baby Driver.
Baby Driver.
Or they pulled it, like, in just
this one. B-A-B-Y, baby.
That's pretty crazy.
B-A-B-B-Y.
Ba-ba-booey. Oh, man. I wish that Howard Stern listened to this show. So let's, now that we've seen the beautiful ending, things are, they're now in love.
Yeah.
Everyone's
why'd you say it?
Love.
They laughed right after that, like,
love.
Everybody loves each other.
That's funny.
Everyone's kissing and
No one died,
which is great.
But I think
that's one FBI agent died. That Ghost probably killed. Like, she stopped his heart. Yeah,
yeah,
yeah. Maybe.
Man, poor bastard.
Maybe he might have survived.
Yeah, he died. No, he died.
He's pretty good. He might have got his chest amputated.
Maybe. Oh, no. Michelle Pfeiffer just needs to touch him, and then he'll be back to life.
Yeah. But that gave you a hint, though, because I told John, I said, hey, notice that nothing bad happened. Everyone came out of it okay. So that's a hint mm-hmm. as to what's about to happen mm-hmm. in the after credits.
And John texted me. That's what made it even worse what happened.
I did. I texted you
so
this
morning. Let's just talk about what happened. Everyone gets fucking dusted.
Yeah, just.
He goes into the. Oh,
and then,
snap.
And then boom. Yeah, all snap, no pun intended.
That's Andrew's pacemaker. Needs its batteries change.
The batteries.
Why do you have AA batteries? How are we going to get in there?
Yeah, you just get the...
Hold on, let me just... It goes in through the butt? Okay, the cool. Let me just get
No, I was doing the snap.
Oh, I didn't know what you were doing. Sorry. So yeah, everyone gets snapped. Wait, is he protected because he's in the
quantum room?
In a different universe, literally.
Boom.
So Ant-Man is in the quantum realm. Literally everyone else is outside just waiting on top of a parking garage for him to come out. No one lets him out. And he's like, come on, guys. But it's because everyone got dusted.
Dusted.
Yeah, so everyone's fucking smoked
out. They're like,
there.
Mr. Stark, I don't feel so good.
Ooh, they all said that in unison at the same time. He wasn't even there. Mr. Stark wasn't even around.
This is a really dark ending only because nothing bad really happens to everybody at the end of the movie.
Yeah, it was just boom.
And then everything bad. Yeah, Lawrence Fishburne, exactly. Gone.
But you knew it was going to happen, right?
Like, right, yeah. I mean, that's the funny thing is, like, I was telling Drew, I saw this coming from a mile away.
It had to lead up to it.
No, it had to, because I was thinking, someone's going to disappear. I was like, if this is not happening during the time of Infinity War, then they need to show someone, like, disappearing.
Yeah.
Or something like that, That's the only thing that could have happened, in other words.
Other than,
like, Captain Marvel showing up or something.
I thought minimally what they were going to see was, like, a screenshot of the aliens coming.
Coming down,
And I was like, okay, that would have been just the minimal thing that they would do. Maximum thing? Fucking dust them.
Kill them all.
But kill them all.
Let God sort them out.
Really dark because, like, you know, Ant-Man has no way of literally getting out. I mean, not a lot of people know that the quantum realm really exists.
Yeah.
All the people who... Do just died.
What if Thanos found out and it's like reality gem? Boom! Take me to the quantum realm. Snap!
Boom! Snap that!
Yeah,
snap.
You just
left
half your body.
Well, you assume that someone's gonna try to figure out who's on the roof or something.
This is when
they
mentions a time vortex too, which is like boom, you can fall in and do like a time travel thing.
Rumor
like,
has it that they go.
Rumor
back
has it.
Rumor.
It's Adele.
It's Adele. Ain't no HP Pavilion shit. basically. There's a rumor that in the next Avengers, they go back in time, and you're thinking, like, how do they do that? They don't have the time.
It's not a rumor. It's pretty...
But if it's not a time stone, is it a quantum realm thing?
Yeah, because Thanos has the time stone, so how can Doctor Strange send them back in time? So maybe it's Ant-Man that gets spit out at the wrong time, and then he's able to kind of usher in.
Maybe he can figure out, like, you know what? I'm here. Get used to it.
Yeah, exactly.
And
boom.
He can find a way to get
also,
out of there.
Also, there's a report of a teenage Cassie Lang being cast in Avengers 4.
What report is this? Are you spreading fake news?
No. Hashtag fake news.
There's an actual
Russia.
Cassie Lang.
Lock
like,
him
different
up.
Actress,
lock him up.
Different actress than the than who's playing Cassie now has been cast in the new one.
Damn it.
So it's like a couple of years later.
I know. Yeah. I like Cassie in both movies.
It's a teenage Cassie Lang that's coming out in Avengers 4.
So Ant-Man's daughter... But older?
Yeah, exactly. So it's kind of weird.
You know, it's not a... Time travel does happen because, guys, they're filming scenes with costumes from the old one.
Oh, no, that's a misdirection.
With their faces shaved, looking like the old one. This is not... Don't be surprised.
Loki's there.
Loki? They film scenes with
Loki's
Loki?
There. Yeah, they film...
Loki.
Come on.
Loki scenes.
Loki. Loki scenes.
Yeah.
Boom. How did that get you?
I feel it.
But yeah, this gets right up to that. This gets you right into Infinity War. Excited. Yeah.
Avengers 4,
prepped,
really.
You should have heard the reaction when we saw it at the theater. Everyone immediately was like, oh.
Well, because it's somewhat surprising.
Was it, though?
It is because I feel it isn't, but it still is.
As soon as we got out of Infinity War, I said, hey, you know how that's going to end? Like this.
Well, it's totally surprising, I guess. Totally different. Then the rest of the movie, happy, everything's great, boom. It didn't matter. Everyone's going to fucking die anyways. But let's talk about the second after credit scene.
Even more depressing for a second.
Because it's almost as if a zombie outbreak happened. Because like,
you hear
all
like, the tone, like the emergency broadcast system. Which is kind of sad because like, it's almost like
The Rapture.
Has anyone seen, like the leftovers or like, you know, the Left Behind?
You mean the real life Rapture that's going to happen soon?
Whenever God snaps his fingers?
No, Macho Man saved us from the first one, remember?
What?
He passed away that day. He gave his life to save us from the Rapture.
Oh my God.
Rest in peace, Macho Man.
Randy Savage?
Yeah, Randy Savage.
Oh God.
The one and only. Yep. Boom.
So yeah, you missed the Rapture.
Yeah, exactly. You already missed it.
But yeah, this ant is playing the drums.
And he's like, no, not bad, actually.
And that was in the fucking trailer. The first after credit scene, in the trailer.
It should have been the ant playing the drums, and then you see him start to disappear also.
He should have played us all.
So it brings us to the final question of this podcast. Did all the ants disappear?
Probably half of them, but half of them is just
not all of them.
A billion ants, a billion million ants. So
a billion ants went down to 500 million ants.
not that bad, unless there's maybe an ant can get him out of there. What if an ant pushes a button on a computer?
Now, I thought that Hawkeye could have came down and like, oh, click this button, bring him back.
How does Hawkeye know?
No, but he's not. You know how he's going to get out of it through the time vortex. He's going to bump into one, get sucked in, and then get shot back out.
Okay, so now let's go into like actual speculating.
Maybe
stuff.
He'll go so far in since you're that doing he it comes anyway. Out.
So far deep that he just pops out.
What if that happens?
What?
I was thinking, no.
He just goes so far in that he's like, oh, I'm out here. I'm Thanos.
Like, what if we really have no idea what Avengers 4... I mean, we don't really.
We
what
do
Avengers
know.
4 is going to be about, and it's going to be like almost like a weird like alternate reality, like Days of Future Past.
Oh, it's
story.
What if it's like the last episode of Lost, and it just starts off in a different reality already?
It's just going to reboot it, so that way they can cast a different Captain America and a different Iron Man.
What if they ignore the other Avengers?
If Ant-Man comes out all that super deranged?
Huh?
Like, if Ant-Man comes out super deranged from the Quantum Realm, because apparently, like, Hank Pym was going crazy before Janet got to him and healed his mind.
Yeah, that's true.
Like, what if he just comes about like a super, totally different person?
You know
like,
what's super interesting?
It's kind
of
crazy.
Is that the Age of Ultron storyline in the comic has a lot to do with time travel and a lot to do with Hank Pym. So they're not that far off from that subject matter. He's not the one that goes back in time. Wolverine goes back in time to try to kill him to stop him from making Ultron.
Oh my gosh. Do you think if the Fox deal comes through in time...
That they go back in time and they're like, Days of Future Past.
Boop. We've seen it before. We'll do it again. Yeah. No, but do you think if the Fox deal clears
Hashtag
in time...
Hashtag proud.
They will throw a little bit of... Throw a little bit of that in there.
A little pepper that
pepper
that
a little
in.
Pepper a little...
Pita, Piper, Pika, Peppa.
Who owns Fantastic Four?
Fox.
Ooh, baby.
I don't think they can do a Fantastic Four in this modern time, but I really hope they prove me wrong.
I think they should get Chris Evans to play both the Human Torch and Captain America.
They need to make a sequel to the one that Josh Trank made.
Oh, shit.
Let's watch that shit, huh?
We don't talk about that one.
Fantastic Four 2.
Fantastic Four Skin. That's what they call that one.
But yeah, exciting stuff. It goes right up there, baby.
Yeah.
Let's go around and give our final thoughts. Final thoughts, Andrew. Tell me to go first.
Yeah, Manuel, go first.
Well, guys, Ant-Man and the Wasp.
All right, I'm going to go first now.
I saw let's do it at the same time.
One, two, three, go. What I thought about Ant-Man and the Wasp was... I can't do this.
Okay, you go first.
Okay, so after seeing it two times, again, I did enjoy it. I do love that it's about family because it makes it a lot more relatable. Not only relatable, but... Also grounded, and I like how personal it is. The world wasn't at stake. It's just us trying to get back mom or us trying to stay clean until I can, you know, visit my family on the outside world again or, you know, me just trying to live, you know. So it's pretty cool and refreshing, a lot real upbeat, and it's a good movie to make you feel good. After Infinity War, even though the ending is kind of a bummer, but the ending is really more of like a lead-in, and I hope he plays a really, really prominent role in the next Avengers movie, since they haven't given him his due with the team yet. He is a founding member along with, obviously the Wasp isn't going to be around, unfortunately, but that would have been cool to see the Wasp take on Thanos with him. Maybe we still might get that. I did hear that there was a scene that they filmed with everybody, even Michael Douglas and Michelle Pfeiffer. I think it was Anthony Mackie or Sebastian Stan that had said that he looked in the room and ended up seeing that, you know, everybody was there. I hope that wasn't him just being on, you know, alcohol and he mistook the photo shoot for that. But, yeah, it leaves me really excited to see both the continuation in Infinity War and in hopefully Ant-Man 3. The box office numbers from Thursday night showings beat both Doctor Strange and the original Ant-Man, which I'm surprised a Marvel movie is going to do good at a box office. It's not a real big surprise, but it's pretty awesome on how fresh they can still be, you know, 20 plus movies in. Boom. Which one of you is next?
It's me.
Rock, paper, scissors?
Okay. Anyway.
I win.
I'm just playing. Ant-Man and the Wasp is a freaking fun movie, which is pretty... it's probably the most upbeat Marvel movie out of, like, every Marvel... You know, everything that we've gotten so far. Really great cast. Everyone's, like, on top of their game. You can totally tell everyone's having a hell of a time. Like, you know, from I don't know about Michael Douglas. I mean, he seems like a kind of serious actor. But, like, Evangeline Lilly's having a great time. You know, Paul Rudd, he's obviously having a great time.
Michael Pena.
Michael Pena is, like, you know, having a ball. Everybody who's involved is just, like, it's so great to be around. Like, it's just, their fun is infectious. So you can not have fun at this movie, other than, you know, Sophia and stuff. But, like, it is a great, like, you know, it's a great romp. It's awesome. It's a really great follow-up to the first Ant-Man movie, which is, like, kind of weird considering that first Ant-Man movie is a Frankenstein of two different directors. This one is tonally different. I love the weird approach to it, like, whether it be, like, you know, the subject matter of, like, this quantum realm and stuff like that.
Yeah.
Or even just the genre, you know, approach to it too. The film genre approach was just kind of like, I felt like it was going towards the romantic comedy route.
I think it was that, definitely.
Yeah, because it's you know, you still haven't seen that in a Marvel movie yet.
Well, yeah, and I said that this was
so far, you know, since then.
It's pretty much one of the purest comedies because, like, yeah, Guardians exactly, is funny, yeah. And it's one of the funniest Marvel movies, but it wasn't a comedy. It's meant to be more serious.
This movie has, like, giant ants, like, walking around, like, and, like, doing worker stuff.
It has slapstick. It has when he becomes Michelle Pfeiffer's character. That's, yeah, it's some slapstick. Classic.
Yeah. It's very
it's OG.
Triple OG
from the hood.
It's almost like Screwball, almost. Like a
Deuce,
like,
Dime.
Right? Isn't it, like, almost like Screwball-ish comedy stuff?
Yeah, it's I mean, you could imagine it being in a Mel Brooks comedy film.
Yeah, exactly. And it's great because, like, you know, Peyton Reed has, like, you know, kind of established the universe now. Now, people technically, I mean, if they do like this, they're going to want a third one, which is pretty awesome. And I love the lead in into Avengers 4. You know, it's a little bit of a bleak ending there for Scott in his own standalone movie because, like, you know, he's kind of stuck there for
a while.
Did you see the Ant-Man and the Wasp will return?
Yeah,
question mark.
Yeah. Which is really funny because, like, I guess they gave it away by saying Ant-Man and the Wasp will return.
That's why everyone was like, oh, and then they put the question mark, and I was like, oh. Everyone was like, oh, and then everyone was like, oh.
Yeah, it should have said Ant-Man and the Wasp and Spider-Man will return, question mark.
Whoa.
And Black Panther. And, just like, yeah, and Okoye and M'Baku.
But it was, it's a fun movie. Like, it kind of gets you over the Infinity War hump there, and then it kind of prepares you for the next phase, which is going to be totally new, since you're doing Captain Marvel and you're introducing Carol Danvers in the 90s and stuff, which is going to be pretty freaking crazy. And it also, that one's going to be a little bit, obviously, more straightforward superhero movie than I feel like this one is, because, you know, that one, obviously they're all going to have humor, but obviously that, you know, that's not going to be like a comedic movie like the way this one is. So it was refreshing to see this, and I never thought I would actually be an Ant-Man kind of fan.
Well, you hate ants and you hate
men, so it's just like, yeah, no, but I didn't think I would actually be an Ant-Man fan, like, looking forward to more Ant-Man shit, basically, and this is pretty awesome.
Yeah,
like, to be that way. So
this fucking shit.
It definitely, that's exactly what it's the whiskey. Now, it's the gigantic. It's the big gulp of whiskey
that you poured me.
That you poured me. Yeah.
Why don't you take another sip, big boy?
Yeah.
I love that. Was weird. Oh boy.
I love sips.
I love this movie so much. Ant-Man is one of the more unique characters in the Marvel Cinematic Universe, who has a very personal tale, and this movie was so tonally different than the rest of the Marvel movies. and definitely different than the Infinity War film that we just watched. And it's a breath of fresh air that I think is required for this moment of time betwixt the twain of two, between the two Infinity War movies, because it reminds you just how personal this is for a lot of the characters. Because we see people who are trying to save the world just because it's the right thing to do. Then we see people who are saving the world because it's something that affects them personally.
And this yeah, you get the
emphasis. Because something we don't know is whether Scott's daughter is gone or whether his family is gone.
Like, right, yeah.
Other than the characters we saw dusted, there's some crazy stuff still happening too. But this movie's funny. Peyton Reed has his own... has full control of this movie and the decisions that he's made. I think the female heroines in this movie are very fleshed out.
And the ghost.
Both wasps are great. Even the ghost has a good storyline. Mm-hmm. I think Ant-Man and the Wasp have equal footing in my head in this movie. Character-wise, and kind of leaning a little bit more to the Wasp in some aspects.
Right. Yeah. There's nothing wrong with that, too, since it's been overdue for her to be in this universe, really. So.
And if you think about it, Peyton Reed is going to maybe make the third one, which means he got to complete
his trilogy.
His trilogy, like, which is like, rare like in the Marvel MCU. Yeah,
he will be like James Gunn, basically.
Yeah, I think we talked about it, right? No one else, really, other than James Gunn.
Yeah, it does. It's an actual sequel, yeah.
Iron Man has all different sequels. Captain America, I mean, the last two are good, but the first one was a different person. Peyton Reed may have his his three.
And Whedon did two Avengers movies, and he's out for that third one.
Yeah, I think it's a great opportunity for him to show just his, I think, reverence to film, because he does model these after. He will go out and tell you the four romantic comedies that inspired this movie, mm-hmm. or what sequences were inspired by something else. So I think Ant-Man is in good hands. I think it definitely has a lot of comedy in it. But yeah, good times. All right, guys. So before we say goodbye until whenever the fuck, do you guys have anything to plug?
Yeah, I do. Listen to I produce a new comic book podcast on the Duffin Pod Network called Fanboy Comics.
Executive produce.
Fanboy!
Executive produce, yeah, exactly.
Fanboy.
You have to, yeah, pronounce it the way these two pronounced it, or else you're not allowed to listen to it.
Yeah.
Fuckboy.
Fuckboy Comics. Have we made this joke already?
Yes, we have. That's why I brought
fanboy.
It back around.
It's Fanboy Comics.
Fanboy!
Clayton is not a fuckboy.
Yeah. Clayton and Mikey are doing some really cool things. If you're a fan of the core characters that we're discussing now in these movies, you may actually get, you know, episode on the... You may get an episode of their actual, you know, incarnations on that
yeah,
podcast.
Yeah, yeah. Actually, Ant-Man and the Wasp just had a comic book series released this past Wednesday. So it's really exciting for these characters, you know, and it helps their evolution when the movies come out. It gets more fans and people interested in the actual source material. So
you buy more of these comics, you may see more of these movies eventually.
Yeah, yeah, for sure. And, I mean, they're on Spotify now, Fanboy Comics, so that's pretty cool. But anything else, John, you had to plug?
Fanboy Comics is really cool. Listen to Missed Connections on the Duffin Pod Network.
Yeah, listen to those things. Well, and while we're talking about these other shows, that way we don't keep plugging the same thing over and again.
I was going to say, not in theaters.
Well, okay.
No.
We'll give some time to that. No. But
forget that podcast. No, I'm saying no.
Yeah, definitely listen to Non-Theaters. It's a new podcast by Lex and Josh. It's really fun.
PK.
I was on the first episode, and then I wasn't invited back. But
horrible guest.
They basically go over some of the movies that... Or,
what if?
Like, yeah,
what
and if it's scenarios? Really fun.
What if scenarios?
I mean, it's like as if the speculation part of this podcast... was in the entire podcast.
Yeah.
And it's really cool because you actually get to hear some really cool ideas. But speaking of all the Duffin Pod shows, we are going to be starting to release little tiny teaser episodes on this channel. So don't unsubscribe, please. If you don't like it, just don't listen to it. But you're going to hear some of the greatest hits from these different shows. And if you like what you hear, definitely find it on wherever you're listening to and subscribe to them as well. Because they're really, really good, and some of them are really close to this in tone.
Yeah.
They're all pretty nerdy.
For sure.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. So yeah,
pick your poison.
Listen to that. Listen to all of those.
Pick your poison. You like movies? You like? Oh, you know, okay.
But don't die. You're not gonna die.
You like comics? Oh yeah, yeah. No.
Revenge of the Sequel. Go listen to Revenge of the Sequel.
ROTS.
Guys.
Nice.
The OG.
Yeah, the ROTS podcast.
I said OG like 10 times.
OG triple OG.
We're kind of on part time status with that podcast right now, but we should be releasing more.
We are part time lovers, full time friends.
Yeah, exactly.
What?
And all of the all of the podcasts on our sister network, Sticker Fridge, which
are we
is
sisters?
Pretty awesome.
Sister.
Brothers.
Sister networks. Oh,
right. Sister brother?
I mean, I didn't want to assume a gender, but...
Oh, okay. Yeah. Well,
we're just siblings.
Yeah.
I didn't know if brother networks was a thing. I thought it was sister network and stuff. Sister.
Ooh. Very, very sexist. Ooh.
Okay, well, whatever.
John, sex is like a free-flowing river that splashes against both shores.
Love is love.
All of this, sister, I was going to say Sister Fridge now. You guys got me fucking tripping up.
Nice.
Sticker Fridge, the Domcast podcast, which is brand new. Busuda Boys, Late Night Swipes, Director Showdown, which I am on this season, which
all
is
the hits.
Pretty great.
There,
yeah.
You're on so many podcasts, John.
I am not
you
on
podcast ho.
Yeah. You know podcasts. What? You're out of this one. Andrew.
But yeah, show them some love too. And that would be pretty awesome.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm.
Drew. Oh, Andrew, you got a brick and mortar, don't you?
Yeah. Yeah. Here we go. Ready? I'm going to say the exact same thing that John just said. We have it on cue cards right behind Emmanuel.
All
right.
Here we go.
No, I'm just kidding. But yeah, listen to everything John said. Everything on the Sticker Fridge.
Rewind if you missed that part.
Yeah, exactly. Everything on the Delphin Pod Network. Be on the lookout for some new exciting projects that all these guys are doing. I think they're going to be a part of the 48 Hour Film Festival.
Whoa.
Yeah.
So we're recording on the set of a horror film. That you won't see for a long time.
Yeah, just trying.
But
some of it is working towards a final product and just getting things under our belt and working with the chemistry of how the ensemble's gonna fit
work wise
in the movie making process. So
you know, one day we'll be doing a Countdown to Infinity episode
about a Marvel movie made.
Yeah, that we're making.
Boom.
And we're going to be defending all the choices that we've made. When we killed Spider-Man.
Yeah. And also, if you
imagine
like
that movie, we're scraping the barrel at the bottom of the barrel at that point. So what are we making? We're making the Eric O'Grady version of Ant-Man.
If we get a meeting with Marvel, all these episodes are going to disappear.
Oh, yeah, definitely, yeah.
And, so
archive
and
them now, folks.
Yeah. Also,
they're going to get dusted.
I know a lot of you like movies and hypothetical scenarios for our other podcasts.
Don't speak for them.
If you like reading also, then come by and visit me over at Heroes and Fantasies and get some of this source material. Again, Ant-Man and the Wasp just had a series come out
comics.
This past week. We can dig up some great new stories or older stories that you might like based on your movie choices or media intake, whether that's cartoons or video games or what have you.
And you talk to people too, right? Like you give really good advice and conversations.
Yeah, we try to recommend things based
outside
on...
outside of comics?
No.
You should put all your money into...
What? Is that what I sound like when I go to work?
Yeah, this is the advice you give people. Ask me about Herbalife.
Actually, sir...
That's all, folks.
Yeah. Visit me at Heroes and Fantasies. Check out a couple of the cool projects that the folks at Heroes and Fantasies have going on to. Rogue Traveler comics, things like that. They have a bunch of reviews where they review comics. Not so much of a podcast, but more of like a blog type thing. And, if you like this stuff, then chances are you'll probably like that other stuff, too.
Yep. Well, guys, it's been great knowing you. It's been great coming into ears one time more again. We appreciate all the people who listen to this.
It's twice. They have two ears.
Well, okay. How about I come in this one, you go in the other one?
Deal.
Yeah, but we will see you pretty soon for the Blu-ray releases of these two movies, because we have a
trivia game.
Yeah, a trivia game for you guys. But it's not going to happen until those actual releases. Yeah, so just maybe. Stay tight.
And then Captain Marvel, and maybe this podcast name changes once a new name is announced.
Oh, the Captain Marvel stuff, and there's some, should we just hint it or not really?
Sure.
There's some discussions about keeping this going for the Marvel Netflix shows, if you guys are a fan of those.
Ooh, baby.
Ooh, that'd be really Luke Cage cool. Has season 2 out
yeah,
right
Luke
now.
Luke Cage is really Marvel's, good. Marvel's if anyone's watching it. Luke Cage yeah. season 2 right now, like that's fucking great. Yeah,
but let's be honest, if that happens, it's just a money grab from us at that point.
Oh, yeah, definitely. I mean, that's totally... Yeah. But full disclaimer, guys.
It's for the passionate Marvel fans. Well, because then when you watch these movies, then you're like, I want more. So you go home and you try to look for the most similar thing that you can.
And you watch all the porn.
Yeah, exactly. After you watch all the porn parodies and the cartoons and play all the video games.
You can only see Thanos' dick 10 times.
Yeah, looks like a purple zucchini, an eggplant, if you will.
A literal eggplant from the emoji.
Yeah, exactly. But, come check it out. At Alamo City Comic Con, there's a character from Luke Cage coming over, Shades.
Whoa.
Shades, yeah. And Luke Cage himself. What am I talking about?
Well, don't plug them. We're not sure if they're
yet. Maybe not. Maybe go fuck yourself.
We have been before, for 4 years.
Yeah. Tom Kenny.
Anyways, we'll see you guys later.
Later, guys.
Bye.